so
ladies
much,
and gentlemen, man. Friends and fans of Valorant, welcome to Spikedown episode number 7. After a short break from the mid-season cup, it's now time to gear up for the stage 2 of the Knights Valorant Challengers season. And of course, I'm Van Silly. Along with me is the one and only Roy. And Roy, how have you been, man? What have you been up to during the, like, this off time that we had? I think we had like two weeks off so far.
Lots and lots of Valorant, man. We had the challengers, we had the playoffs, we had the midseason cup, we have VCT going on. It's completely ruining. I know it's ruining your sleep schedule.
Yeah.
My sleep schedule is kind of chill. I'm trying to keep it tame. Yeah, he's jet lagged in it while he's in NA. That's actually an achievement.
Yeah, that's actually quite funny. I've actually been watching your content as well. I was watching you give some feedback and coaching on how to play Lotus like a pro. So I watched the video. I've been learning, and already I'm doing great. I'm already 0-4 this season. But yeah, let's get into it, man. Let's exactly. I can play just like Roy now, which is just continuously lose.
Perfect. Amazing. Exactly.
But without further ado, let's actually get into the meat and potatoes of things, because we, of course, were just talking about the mid-season cup that just happened in prior to the stage 2 that's about to happen and start this week. But I wanted to digest that a little bit more and get our reactions a little bit about that mid-season cup and results on potentially like, is this what we expected for some of these teams, right? And I think the writing's on the wall or the elephant in a room that I'd like to address with you, Roy. The first one is M80, you know?
We're just starting like that. Okay.
Yeah, dude, I'm right off the gates, dude. We're going hot.
Okay.
So I'll have to admit, and I think it's no surprise though, it's been an underwhelming result for M80 going into the playoffs. I know it's only single elimination, but when on paper and going into the event when you were the team to beat last year and unfortunately lost their guard in the Ascension, and then looking at the roster you put in together for this year, you should still be there like uncontested, like that number one spot, you know? But unfortunately, like I just mentioned, it's been underwhelming. They underperformed. They had a very close game that potentially even could have been a loss for them already when they played against TSM, because, you know, let's face it, that game against TSM, the first one on Breeze, they kind of threw that round of 24. We're trying to shorty the last person inside that pit. And then suddenly we got into overtime where maybe TSM potentially even won that. And if TSM won that one, they would have been a series 2-0.
Exactly. Yeah, you're absolutely right.
So what happened to M80 so far in the midseason cup?
I mean, it's honestly kind of hard to say. I think, like, for me instinctively, like, the one thing that I can definitely talk about is, like, with confidence at least, is the fact that the two players that they really relied on last year were Nismo and Koala, and they both seem to be in some sort of slump. I feel like Koala's clawed his way out of the slump a little bit, but I mean, Nismo and Koala have been underperforming, and these are players that they really depended on, right? Like, they're some of the most flexible players on the team, and they're just not putting up the same numbers that they were last year. And now just things are seem just a little bit out of funk, right? And I mean, just think about it, right? Like, if Koala and Nismo are performing even 20% better than they are, almost all their matches are just clean victories, realistically.
Yeah.
Like, all their matches have been close, right? Like, it's very rarely do they get swept. Like, it was 13-8 on Ascend versus Turtle Troops, but like almost all their games have been close, and it seems like they're missing a bit of an edge. And it comes down to, like, obviously I can't put it completely on the two players, but I mean, stylistically, it does feel like they're just a bit too predictable now. It feels like, at least, like they're playing too structured. It feels like,
I wanted to ask you about that actually, in terms of, you know, the play style or the style that M80 brings this year. And you're mentioning that it's too predictable. Is it because of the loss of John Cutie now, who's been IGLing Sentinels to a Masters, where, you know, maybe not the best results for Sentinels at stage one during the VCT, but losing John Cutie, technically, if you're looking on paper, though, you have still Captain America with Nitro that came from, you know, CS to Valorant to CS back to Valorant. And with all of that experience as an IGL or an Opera or Fragger, whatever role that he played back in CS and now in Valorant, is it still like is there still a gap in terms of trying to lead, you know, players like Nismo and Koala Noob that's different than John Cutie?
Yeah,
that could be fixed for stage two here.
Yeah, I mean, dude, think about it. Like, their head coach is happy CS veteran, right?
Yeah.
Their other IGL CS veteran. They're both playing CS in a Zoomer Valorant game. So I imagine there's probably some sort of like too much thinking fundamentally and less pew 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 going on, right? Mm-hmm. Like, before, not only did they lose John QT, but they also lost EU. EU is always down to scrap. Like, he's a very scrappy player. Like, yeah, he plays his role extremely well, but he's always down to scrap in the server. And I think it just, when I'm watching them, they don't feel like they have that edge where it's like, you know, there's some unexpected things, like players could take over rounds. Like, it doesn't really look like that. It just looks a lot of like just team fights going on, just like pretty standard kind of vanilla Valorant going on. So maybe they just need a little bit more Zoomer energy on the team or something.
Yeah, I think overall, though, if I'm looking at this roster from M80 on paper, I think it still has to be a roster that looks good, right?
It's like, great. Yeah, it's a great roster. There's nothing wrong with it.
It's probably like one of those storylines where you're looking at, for example, Energy. You're trying to build a super team that on paper is supposed to win trophies. And this time for M80, it's supposed to win Ascension, right? You brought in BCJ, somebody that, you know, the owner of M80 knows quite well from the days back in Exet and knows what BCJ could bring to the table. Even BCJ deadlifted one of those maps on Breeze previously.
Yeah, he's
which helped M80 get... Exactly. And if it wasn't for him on that first map, maybe even M80 would have lost in that round of 12 or whatever it's called, right? Just before they got to their quarterfinals. So that was, you know, like some great plays coming out of BCJ that really allowed M80 to look good and just scrap. You mentioned scrappiness, right? So BCJ definitely has what it takes if you want to compare to EU. And I also just think also that, you know, despite me saying that it's been very underwhelming for M80, there's still great leadership around, as you said here, Happy and Nitro. But I feel that maybe they do need a little bit more time to find that link that would actually make them that strong super team like where we expect them to be. But man, that clock is ticking right now, and stage two is coming up, and they're not going to be coming up with they're not going to be starting with an easy match, and we're going to talk about that a little bit later. But at least for now, like I gotta say, it was, I think everybody agrees, and I think the team would agree itself for MED that, you know, it's probably not the result that they wanted going into the midseason cut. But then moving forward, let's talk about, you know, one team that I think surpassed the expectations, right? So we're going to Extremities here in different polarities. And I think the other one or the team that I want to talk about here is Turtle Troop. So is now Turtle Troop their Turtle Truth, right? Like they came
the
in
Truth Troopers.
That's what I'm saying. They came in. Play, like, had to fit in the shoes of We Did insane. Was sipping pina coladas or something like that and watching the games on his cell phone while he's on vacation, and he's seeing this team of Turtle Troop unsigned make it all the way to the grand finals against OXG, Oxygen Esports. So, you know, you mentioned it in your broadcast, and you're on the desk, you have to stop doubting Turtle Troop. But what convinced you about this team when you finally start or you finally saw them play here during the midseason cup?
Listen, the Truth Troopers had the first conquest. It was to prove that they were good, and honestly, they defeated me. I was a denier for a while. I kept voting against them. All my predictions were against Turtle Troops, and I'm not making that same mistake this stage. And maybe when I start voting for them, they're actually gonna fall off. Who knows? But they're not fluking their matches. Like genuinely, they are not fluking their wins. They're playing extreme good Valorant. They have very well thought out setups. And the one thing that for me is like kind of like a standout thing is they are totally down to throw the structure off. Like players will get in positions that if you're studying the Valorant, you're like, oh, this position doesn't really make sense. Like why is this guy in this position in a 5v4, right? Like it's too aggressive. But then they, you know, Adder gets three from that position. It's like they're totally down to kind of flip the script a little bit and not really play the most logical Valorant. And I think it's that sort of chaos that they create with this like quote unquote illogical level of Valorant is what gives them the edge, because they can back it up with mechanics.
Yeah, I do agree with that as well, because if you're looking at Turtle Troop, or you're just thinking about the history of Turtle Troop at the same time too, it's always been a team that has to go through so many roster shuffles with teams going and getting, or players getting going to different teams, getting picked up, getting scouted, or We Did go on a vacation, and they have to just kind of like wing it. But it almost looks like because of that, you're just going to naturally think that this team is going to have to pug it out. But technically, it doesn't really look like it's a puggy style, but more of like a loose style that really allows for them individually to excel. I think even Seller mentioned that as well. And you were mentioning like sometimes they find themselves in these awkward positions that pull out in their favor. And I think that's the result of them versus M80. I still remember the Ascent game where somehow Stellar has a Guardian, and usually as a Sova on CT or on defender side, you're trying to recon dart and trying to hold and try to get wall bangs when the executions are coming. Instead, he's going back back into mid and gets a backstab on two players and kills them with a guardian. I'm like, how is this happening? Like, how are M80 able to find these type of, or sorry, how are Turtle Trooper able to find these type of timings against M80? But I guess the question comes down to, you now that you figure it out, you notice here that the playstyle is too loose, will it actually stand on its 2 feet for a longer time than you expect here going into stage two?
Dude, I've been asking that same question for a whole stage. I honestly don't. I don't know. I don't know the answer. Loose is weird term,
right?
Right, exactly. Like, loose is a weird term because they look loose, but they also are playing within a system that allows individual expression, right? So is that really loose at that point, or is there just like they understand their boundaries of where they can express themselves and where they can, where they have to kind of fall in line with the rest of the team? And I think it's that level of kind of like just no pressure gameplay. Also, shout out to Stellar, by the way. That dude is probably providing the least stressful environment possible for his team. They honestly just look like they're happy to be there, dude. Maybe this is the happy to be here buff. Who knows? But no, they're playing great. And I imagine they're going to keep that train rolling forward, especially now that they have weeded back for stage two.
Yeah. And especially when you hear Stellar in these post-match interviews, he already has a very calm demeanor that also doesn't seem like he's going to like tilt or anything like that too. So it almost feels like his loose style is like they play loose because Stellar knows the potential and what a player could bring individually. And then where he could actually pull them back, and also where he could say, hey, just let loose and go. And we know what to do and how we could capitalize if we're in an early 4v5 to bring it back into our favor. So I think, I agree with you. Lots of laurels to go on to Stellar because he's done amazing calling so far with Turtle Troop. He's done some amazing calling in the past as well with Hunter Thieves, and has done some amazing calling in the past with LG. You know, there were always a team that were like, as LG, the boring team to watch, but the team that were always consistent in like that top four going into the challengers of last year in the VCTs. So yeah, that's probably the biggest asset for me looking at Turtle Troops, to see now Stellar still be able to call like a king and make the team look so good. But speaking of go ahead. Sorry.
It's fine. TLDR, I think the word is trust. Like, they just have trust in each other realistically. Yep. Like, they all kind of understand their role. But correct me if I'm wrong, but Turtle Troops are the only team in the league that doesn't actually have a coach, which is kind of wild to think about.
Yeah, and I think Stellar mentioned that too in the post-match interview. Is like, I think they're afraid at some point that, you know, bringing the coaching a coach in or adding more structure to that team will maybe make things bit more difficult to start. But I'm sure that they're the type of team, because they are also a free agent team that's been looking to get signed for the longest time. I'm sure that if it has to come down to that moment that they need a coach, or an org wants a coach to coach for this team, they'll accept that as well. Because if you're looking at, if I want to do like a apples to apples comparison, I could maybe think of, for example, the Sentinels of like 2021 with like the Shaz Tens, like that Zom's roster of the past, where, you know, they never had a coach come in, and then finally, like, they were a little bit too stubborn for the longest time and finally realized that they were in that slump. And then they brought in, like, for example, Rockets to help out or something like that, you know? So, I think that Stellar and a group at Turtle Troops would also be able to identify that earlier and accept that they need some help, and they will go and get it when they need it. But for now, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. So I'm down with it. I mean, they got first in their group. They got to the grand finals of the MSC. They're looking great in the standings, which we're going to see in a bit. So yeah, just keep going and keep trucking so far. I think they're now really like the dark horse of potentially even making it to the Ascension.
Are they the dark horse? They're the number one standing team. Dark horse just feels like an insult to their achievements at this point. They're just light horse.
They were a dark horse starting, but yes, definitely coming into the light, I guess, at that point. But yes, definitely a team to beat at this point. Maybe we have a new dark horse going to stage two that we're going to have to talk about in a bit. But at least let's move on here to the next team I like to talk about, because I think when you're looking at, you know, the challengers scene, and in general, we always thought that it was top three heavy, right? It was going to be the MXS, the OXG, and the M80s of the world. We just talked about Turtle Troop now, because now it has to be the strong four, right? Looking at the start of stage two. But then now I want to talk about OXG. They actually look amazing. I think for me personally, if I was looking at all of these top four dogs, the top four dogs going into stage two on, or stage one even on paper, I thought OXG for me would be like the second or third and M80 at the top. But at this point now, Oxygen Esports, they just won the grand finals here of the Midseason Cup. Mitch is looking awesome on so many different roles. Dapper is having great moments, but I think overall, there's a lot of consistency coming out of the young fraggers of Verno, Scuba, and Redux,
dude.
That really, it makes Oxygen Esports a whole, and I understand now why this team wants to stick together and be like the next guard, pretty much, and now slash G2, because they feel that they could win it as a group. So I think you'll agree with me, Roy, that we could just gas them up with saying like this team is looking like a top contender right now, even maybe even be able to beat some teams during on the VCT stage.
Yeah, I mean, just judging purely off the Midseason Cup results, I would say that Oxygen looks like the best team in the tournament. Even if you remove their win from the grand finals, I would still say that they look like one of the best teams in the league right now, to be honest. But yeah, their season one was a little, or stage one rather, it was a little choppy, I would say. Their highs were really high, but their lows were also a little too low. But I mean, now at this point, I think they're firing on all cylinders. Like you mentioned, Redux, Verno, and then Scuba, obviously they're doing extremely well. But also Father Mitch is coming in, and now he's putting up performances in the IGL role. And then they have Dapper, a previous international winner, who's closing out rounds for them. And it's just like, it's clicking. I see the vision, and it's beautiful. It's beautiful.
Well, will it be at some point though that MXS versus Oxygen Esports as the El Clasico, that Moistex Shopify could actually beat Oxygen Esports? Because at this point, it almost feels like, you know, Oxygen is MXS's kryptonite, because every single important match, I'm going to put it like that, during the offseason when everybody is practicing and getting ready for stage one, it's always been on the side of Oxygen. Yes, yep. MXS won one map during our one series during the week, but when it came down to, again, what's quote unquote important here, getting the circuit points, qualifying for the Challengers playoffs, it was still Oxygen Esports beating Moistex Shopify in a single elimination BO3. So what seems to be, I mean, there was a lot of trash talking about that, by the way, from Redox at the end of the day too.
He was trash talking his own teammates.
Yeah,
he wasn't even trash talking the enemy. He was trash talking his own teammates. And I was like, dude, what is so
funny.
Going on?
That is so easy. He's a funny love guy, dude.
Funny.
At this point, I guess there's almost like an El Clasico slash a feud that I like to start and stir the pot here between Oxygen Esports and MXS, at least in the server, not outside the server, of course. But MXS, what do they need to do now to find like that stronghold in that spot that they're really that team to look out for going to make it to the Ascension playoffs?
All right, so before I answer that question, I do want to provide the chat with the Vansili translation. Basically, what he's saying, chat, is the fact that he's saying Moistex Shopify is the cloud nine of challengers, and they only seem to do well in group stages and not in playoffs where it matters the most. That's his words, not mine. I'm just simply translating.
I think you're paraphrasing.
Yeah.
But you know what? Kind of true.
I mean, you're kind of right, though. Basing it purely on their head-to-heads from their history, it seems like every time it's gone to like a very important match, a grand final or like some sort of semifinals match, it has been Oxygen Esports who comes out on top. I can't really pinpoint why. Like, when I'm watching Moistex Shopify, I see their ideas. They're very clearly good ideas. Like, they master defense. In my opinion, they're playing one of the best defenses in the league. They, like, they're at least on paper, right? Like, they're masking all their setups. They're playing very anti-meta kind of style, where it's like, it's really hard to unravel what they're doing quickly without overcommitting and like getting a lot of information.
Yeah,
they do really good. They're very versatile. They have a lot of traps. They have a lot of individual expression. They're all shooters. Like, every single person on that team, like, they have a hardworking IGL who's also like, what, 19, 18 years old. Like, give Fly some respect, but like, they have everything that they need. So I'm not entirely sure why they're not really winning the important matches, to be honest. Maybe there's too much pressure, but I mean, dude, we also kind of have to talk about the fact that all of Moist Shopify's results have been super close, like 2-1s, 13-11s on the last map against Oxygen Esports.
Slow starts in some series too during the weeks of the regular stage. So yeah, it's been.
They're not
been
map oneers, that's for sure.
Exactly. So it's they definitely have to fight for their victories and make sure that their name is out there. But I think it's very similar to a lot of these teams, right? Because again, to go back to our top of show, like M80 is in the same boat for me when it comes down to that. So I guess it brings down to this part then. After being able to digest the stage one and the mid-season cup, and we're focusing here on now the top four being M80, MXS, Oxygen Esports, and Turtle Troops. Where do you currently rank them in terms of the one Ooh. To four into our four, top four teams?
Wow. Okay. That's a good question. My instinct says Oxygen is number one, but we didn't get to see Turtle Troops with full strength. Like Silenx did a great job. Shout out to that boy. Okay? Yeah. He did amazing, but he's not weeded, and they've been practicing with weeded for a long time. So I feel like
they almost won.
That's madness. But yeah, so in my mind, it's Oxygen, but Turtle Troops at full strength is kind of in between these two teams right now. It's either Turtle Troops or Oxygen, but recency bias, I have to give it to Oxygen. They looked impeccable throughout the entire event. So I'm going to give number one to Oxygen. I'm actually going to give number two to Turtle Troop, and then it's Moist for third and M80 for fourth.
Oof.
That's my rankings.
Yeah. And was M80 your number one going into stage one? Like before the season even started?
Before anything happened, yes, they were my number one.
Yeah.
It seemed like a no-brainer. Like everything on paper looks so good.
Yeah. And that's the crazy part too, because now I do agree with you with this ranking. I pretty much had it the same, actually exactly the same as yours. So then it comes down to once we get to finishing stage two and finishing the playoffs, will we still see Oxygen Esports and Turtle Troop in a grand finals to see who goes there to the Ascension playoffs with the other regions to play for ascending to the VCTs. That'll be an interesting watch. And that's a great opportunity to start things off, because that's going to happen in stage two, right? We have stage two coming up, and then it's going into the Challengers playoffs, and then the Challengers playoffs top two will be going to the Ascension playoffs. So let's talk about it a bit and explain the format of stage two going into this, because so far, let's pull it up if you can. We'll look at the standings that we currently have after all of stage one and mid-season cup has been completed. If you're looking at it so far, and I'm going to pull it myself as well, we currently have Turtle Troop at number one with 13, followed by MoistX Shopify's tied with Oxygen Esports at 12, M80 at 10, and Core Gaming SAD Esports at 8 and 6 respectively. And then we got like the bottom six that are still quite close, and they could still make this very doable, because how it's going to work in stage two is, depending where you place in your group, you're going to now get more points than you did in stage one. So if you're first in your group in stage two, you're allotted 13 points instead of, I think it was 10 in the past, right? So it'll count down to 13 for first, 10 for second, 8 for third, 5 for fourth, 3 and 1. So you actually have an opportunity now to gain more points and even topple the other teams. And another thing that's important to note is that in stage one, you're playing teams that were in the opposite group, right? So if you're in group A, you're playing group B. But now, very similar to the VCTs going into stage two, you're actually playing against opponents. Exactly. You're actually playing against opponents of your own group, which then means, looking at week number one, we actually have a big matchup to kick things off, right? We have an M80 game versus Oxygen Esports. And I think that probably is going to be the big match to watch this week. Like, has M80 fixed things quickly in the last, 2 weeks of break that they've had? And can they turn it around? And can we have more hopium about M80 again? But if we're looking now at the schedule of this week, right, we got six matches coming up. Are there any games that catches your eye so far here, Roy?
I mean, I think the first one that you talked about is definitely a good one. Oxygen versus M80, you can't go wrong. It is going to be a very important match. I would like to see the resurgence of kind of like the lower end teams. Like, yeah, it's easy to kind of pick and choose the top six, right? But like, is anyone going to surprise us? Like, YFP has made a lot of changes. You know, are they going to perform well? You know, like Winthrop University's made changes as well going into the split. How are they doing in this stage? Like, there's gonna be a lot. Again, like you said before, right? Like the point system is a lot more heavy now compared to stage one and midseason cup. So anyone could swoop that playoff spot and make it into the into the playoffs, right?
Yeah.
It could, anything could really happen. But again, I think from my POV, the first week of matches is always like the feeler matches. Like, you know, what are people doing? Are there any comp swaps? Have they kind of changed their map pool, right? Like I did talk previously about M80's map pool. I don't like that they permaban Sunset and they play Breeze, considering that they have so much experience on the team. I would like to see them play Sunset and actually drop Breeze and not play that map. But we'll kind of see. So that, for me, like it's also TSM versus Blinn. I feel like we didn't really get to see, one, we didn't get the chance to see Blinn in their full strength. Two, TSM has a lot to prove this stage, and I think they're out for blood here.
Well, let's talk about it a bit, actually. So Blinn Esports comes in from play-ins. You said they were playing with the full roster, trying to figure things out. But then, you know, the results were pretty okay. You know, they went through the play-in relegation. They won that one. They qualified through back with Dobros. I was able to say that correctly this time, right?
But, hey, congratulations. Yeah.
Thank you, man. Blinn, how do you think they'll fare now, looking that now they have to play against like this group that they're currently in, and they have to play against TSM. We had the conversation just earlier on of like, you know, dark horses for me, that was Turtle Troop going into stage one, but now a team to beat. Who would be your new dark horse going into stage two? Could it be a team like Blinn?
Yes, I think it definitely can be. Okay, let me start this with a history lesson, okay? Don't call me old. Fans, I know you're smiling right now.
I don't think I could ever call you old because, you know, and I'm already ancient.
All right. So chat, don't call me old. All right.
Call them old.
Blinn Esports got knocked out of the midseason cup by Turtle Troop in a 3-map series that went into overtime on the third map. Like, if the Turtle Troops went all the way, they went all the way to the finals. The person that knocked him out was one of the grand finalists. And this was their first event in Challengers. You kind of have to give a little bit of respect to them. 13-8 loss on the first map on Ascent to Turtle Troops. Second map was a 13-9 clean victory on Split. And then Bind went into overtime. Come on, for their first match. And like, that's kind of nuts, no? You kind of have to give them a little bit of respect here. A little dark horse energy, in my opinion.
Now that you've freshened my memory about this, yes, I do agree now that I'm a little sold actually on Blinn being one of the dark horses. Because on my end, I thought it was going to be the opposite. For me, I thought it was going to be TSM that was going to be the dark horse of stage two, because again, we've mentioned it. They almost won that what could have been a 2-0 for TSM if they didn't gas up, if they didn't gas out on a third map against M80 on Lotus, right? I don't think they won a single defensive round on Lotus, unfortunately, in the third map. Mm-hmm. But they were so close to closing the first map in overtime on Breeze, and they looked really good on that second map. So for me, it looked like, you know, they've been putting a lot of practice into it. I know that they've been almost, I think they were boot camping even at some point, or if not, at least getting to a functional schedule that allows for them to look really, really good during the midseason cup, where I thought that now they could be the dark horse. But all right, Roy, so let's just cut straight to the chase and go right into predictions. We've already hyped up the first game of this week, which is going to be Oxygen Esports versus M80, but we didn't have a chance to predict it yet. So I'm going to let you take the floor first and let me know who you're picking for this match.
At this point, we have hyped up Oxygen way too much to not vote for them. So I'm going with Oxygen. Otherwise, we just look dumb at this point.
Yeah, I agree with you. Okay, so let's go with that. So Oxygen over M80. Then we have Fluffy Aimers versus Winthrop University. I'm going to have to go and start with Fluffy Aimers. They look good. They literally brought some great aimers through. They brought it to the distance against a team like MXS in the midseason cup. They've already beaten Winthrop University in the midseason cup. And yeah, the extra firepower that they brought, I think, are great additions for them to go pretty far here in stage two.
Yep, I completely agree. And I think now they've had more time to develop as well. So I think the roster is looking quite nice. I'm also going to go with Fluffy Aimers. We're going to keep it vanilla for this one, Vans.
All right. YFP versus SAD Esports. If I'm not mistaken, SAD Esports, don't know if it's official yet, but I mean, a little leak.
Redo that.
So YFP versus SAT Esports. Now, if I'm not mistaken, SAT Esports, maybe it's a leak or not. I can't confirm nor deny, but I
think just leak it, man. Screw it.
All right. So I've heard that SAT Esports have gone through some roster changes, and it actually looks pretty good. They brought in a new IGL, Bing Dip. I'm assuming he's going to be IGLing for this team, and he's an ex-teammate of Darkest. And if I remember those days of Northwood University with those two playing together, I think that is going to be a stellar lineup. And I think they might be able to overtake YFP in their opening match as a new roster.
Ooh, okay. I was actually leading the complete opposite way here. I'm thinking they, although yes, they do have experience together. Yes, they have played together.
Finally don't agree.
Yes, finally. I never thought it would happen. Usually off camera, we're disagreeing on everything. But now we're on camera, we're on the same team. What the heck's going on here?
You're scared, bro. You're scared to disagree with me.
No, I'm here. I am. I think YFP actually looks great. I love their new roster. I think they've had time to develop. Obviously, they're kind of in the same shoes that Fluffy Aimers were in, where they didn't really have much time to develop after their roster changes. But I think now they're looking quite nice, and I think they've had time to develop. And now SAD's in the same shoes they were in before, where now they have to kind of rework everything. So I'm going with YFP.
Okay. MXS versus Dobros. Any upsets in that one?
No.
So Dobro's going to win.
Yes, exactly.
No, kidding aside, no, I do agree with you. I think it's going to be MXS versus Dobros. I mean, Dobros just came back from relegation. They look still pretty decent going into the midseason cup, but MXS is still a top three powerhouse here going into the challengers, as we talked about it in the past. And as we also hyped up, like, the dark horses of stage two potentially now is in this matchup. So Blinn versus TSM. I was still leaning towards TSM, and I'll still think that TSM is going to win this series. But do you go for Blinn at this point because of the gas up that you gave for this team?
So I think yes. You know what? Yes. I'm just going to go ahead and disagree with you. I'm going to go with Blinn Esports. Before I completely lock this one in, though, I do want to say that I think TSM and Blinn are both the dark horses of this stage. Okay. I do want to preface by saying that I think both these teams have a lot to prove. And I think TSM is either going to become superheroes or they're going to get crumbled by the pressure that they've had on them on top of themselves. And I think it could go either way. But Blinn looked great, and they lost. I mean, just a quick recap, they did lose to the grand finalists in a third map overtime. So they're already closed the gap. So I think they're about to show off here.
I still think that TSM looked pretty good, right? They brought up a good fight against M80, although maybe not at the same tenure as Blinn versus Turtle Troop, because Turtle Troop still made it to the grand finals. But TSM almost won that 2-0 against M80. I think they turned it around as well. And as you say, they could be hot or cold. I'm assuming you're also thinking there's no in between. Yep. And I kind of agree with you with that as well. But I think right now they're at a point where they're warming up, and it's pretty much that tipping point. Or that turning point that we're waiting for here at stage one. This is a great test to start things off, especially with the potential that Blinn could bring now into stage two. If TSM could have a very strong victory here to start things off, I think they're going to head towards that hot direction here going into stage two. So
it's kind of like winning pistol in your match. Like, you win pistol and that now everyone's got confidence. Win the first. Yes. And the, okay. Yeah,
so week three, we'll see if TSM wins the match in week three, and then they'll be the bonus, and then they're in a good spot here. And then we know they're going to steamroll this and get like a set one Brazilian scoreline here going into the weeks. But last but not least, let's go into Core and Turtle Troop. I think at this point we will unanimously say. You're saying a gamble?
No, I'm saying it's going to be a good game.
Oh, okay. I thought you were like, a gamble left and right. But I think it's going to be a good game, but I still think it's going to be Turtle Troop.
I mean, dude, Turtle Troops is up there for the number one team in the league. I think they're going to keep that going. They're going to have Weeded back. It's all going to be amazing. And their honeymoon is extended further into this match. And I think Turtle Troops are going to take this one. But it might not be as clean as we think it might be.
Mm, okay. I think it's going to be clean. I think Turtle Troops is amazing. Yeah.
Sweet 2-0. Clean.
Sweet 2-0. Sweet 2-0. Maybe not like a dominant 2-0, but I still think that it's going to end in a 2-0 record. But I think the rounds will definitely be close in between the teams.
I see.
But overall, it's probably still a 2-0 at this point. Turtle Troop, I'm convinced after watching them overall. But with that goes through all the predictions and everything we have to talk about. leading into stage two that's starting this week. So make sure you tune in right now onto twitch.tv or YouTube or whatever you choose to watch your favorite games here for the Knights NA Challengers and for Vansil and Roy. I think we're going to call this a night. Thank you so much, Zippo, and we'll see you next week for Spike Down.